testimony in the murder trial. As it happens, there is a reason well-known murder case from the 1890s in which the alleged ghost accusations of a young murder victim helped convict her husband of the crime. Unfortunately, while the Greenbrier ghost story became a local legend in West Virginia, where the case occurred, the facts tend to be a bit more mundane. It all began on January 21st, 1897. The Greenbrier County, West Virginia, when the body of Zona Hester Shue was found on the floor of the house she shared with her new husband, Edward Stripling Shue, better known as Trout, an errand boy, Anderson Jones discovered the body. According to Jones' testimony, the dead woman was lying face down at the foot of the stairs, with one arm tucked under her chest and the other arm extended. Since Jones immediately notified her husband, Trout Shue arrived home before the police could investigate. Trout moved the body to her bed to bundle things further before the coroner arrived. Even while Dr. George Knapp's coroner made his investigation, Trout was loudly wailing over Zona's dead body. The doctor stopped his examination and signed the
Zona's neck and contusions to her esophagus, with fractures to her
exactly as the mother described. The autopsy doctors concluded Zona's shoe died from a broken neck and manual strangulation. During the inquest that follows, Shroud's shoe face bristly grilling about his whereabouts at the time of Zona's death. Though he denied responsibility, Zona's death was ruled a homicide and Shroud was charged with murder. The trial took place in June 1897 and ran for 8 days. Shroud hired William Reckler and James Garner to defend him. Garner was an intriguing choice since he was the first black man to practice in a circuit court in West Virginia. John Preston knew full well what people would think of Mary Jane as a strange story, so he deliberately avoided calling her to testify in the murder trial that began on June 22nd. Instead, he concentrated exclusively on the physical evidence, including testimony from the Trout Shoe. He also focused on his behavior before and after Zona's death, including his ill-considered boast that he would eventually have 7 wives. Zona was only his 3rd. Reckler and Garner knew their client faced execution if convicted of first-degree murder, so they decided to focus on Mary Jane Hester and her claims of seeing her daughter's ghost. They likely hoped her bizarre testimony would discredit her entire case against their client. Unfortunately, she was a more compelling witness than they anticipated. While on the stand, Mary Jane was empathetic that Zona's ghost appeared to her 4 times and described how her husband killed her. She also testified about the burial sheet under Zona's neck during her wake. Shroud gave it to Mary Jane as a keepsake after the funeral, and she insisted that the sheet turned red after she washed it in some weeks later. Bizarre murder cases in Chicago's history began when 22-year-old Mary Verzell first visited the Great Billick card reader and seer in 1904. Within months, most of her family was dead, and he was on trial for their murder. There isn't much known about the early history of the man who called himself Herman Billick. Born in what was called Bohemia, later the Czech Slavic Republics, something easier for Americans to pronounce. An all-around confidence artist, fortune teller, and mystic, Billick developed a reputation by telling fortunes, passing on messages from the great beyond, and selling various quack nostrums, including love potions. According to one account, Mary Verzal visited Billick for a love potion to rekindle a local butcher's affection for her sister, Emma. Whatever the original reason for the meeting, the Verzal family, the huckster, quickly discovered that Mary Verzal had a prosperous milk business, a comfortable nest egg and lovely home on West 19th Street in Chicago, that he shared with his wife and seven children. This was enough for the great Billick, and he soon integrated himself within the Verzal family. One day, he visited Martin at the milk business and suddenly spoke in tongues. The sight of this well-spoken fellow Czech proclaiming, "You have an enemy. He is trying to destroy you." And it probably was him. Was enough to sway Martin to bring the great Billick home to meet the rest of his family. Martin was already engaged to a fierce business battle with a rival milk producer, so having Herman cast a spell to help his business made sense. Mary Verzal was already one of Billick's customers, but Martin's wife, Rosa, appeared his prime target. Even though he was married, Herman Billick had no problem seducing Rosa and making her part of his bizarre murder scheme. Based on what came from Billick's trial, he reportedly convinced Rosa Verzal to help him poison his wife and mother and most of her family to collect on the insurance policies. After Billick's wife was dead, he would then marry Rosa, exactly how Herman Billick was able to gain such complete control over Rosa. Verzal is a mystery, but members of her family began dying shortly afterwards. Martin Verzal was the first to die on March 27, 1905. Martin's insurance policies, money, and the proceeds from selling their house yielded a tidy $2,000. Mind you, this is the early 1900s, but that was not enough for Rosa and her new betrothed. A few months later, Mary Verzal died, and a second daughter, Tilly, died. In December of that same year, the insurance payout for both daughters was only $1,400. Two more daughters died the following year, though their insurance payments were only several hundred dollars apiece. But things were going wrong for Rosa Verzal. The police took a closer look at the suspicious deaths, and Herman Billick had already pocketed all the insurance money. Even worse, Billick's wife and mother were both still alive, since he refused to poison them, as he initially promised Rosa. That meant she was left to destitute, with only Billick's promise to marry her. In December 1906, police issued warrants for the arrest of Herman Billick and Rosa Verzal. Autopsies conducted on all six exhumed bodies determined they died of arsenic poisoning. Billick was arrested, but Rosa committed suicide with arsenic before police caught up with her. The trial of Herman Billick proved to be as bizarre as anyone could imagine. The oldest Verzal daughter, Miss Emma Neiman, testified that Billick had a manifold influence over her and her mother. She told the police that Billick had drawn the two of them to meet him in Cleveland, Ohio on a one-on-one occasion. He also cabled the Verzal family requesting money repeatedly, at times demands for cash often ran into hundreds of dollars. The Verzal family had to borrow from their neighbors to raise the sum needed. Emma also said Billick personally dosed her father and sister with what he described as medication. Since Emma's husband was one of the victims, she became under suspicion, though police later cleared her of any wrongdoings. Martin and Rosa's son, Jerry, testified he heard Billick and Rosa scheming to murder his father in the days before his if I was all right, they would take me with them. He said otherwise, he would kill me. As far as Rosa's suicide, Jerry claimed Billick hypnotized her to kill herself to protect him from prosecution. Thanks to Jerry Vercel's testimony, Herman Billick had no choice but to admit swindling the Vercel family out of their savings, but flatly denied anything to do with the deaths. Though there was no evidence of his purchase of arsenic, Billick still received the death sentence for the murder of Mary Vercel. The other charges were dropped. His lawyer won a stay of execution by appealing the sentence and promptly worked to change public opinions about Billick's guilt, along with orchestrating the new stories that called for Billick's retrial. Jerry Vercel suddenly repudiated his testimony and severely damaged the case. Besides, Billick denied any part of the poisonings or sinful relationships with Rosa Vercel. Prosecutors also had to contend with Chicago's large immigrant community, a priest, Father P.J. O'Callahan, and a nun, Sister Rose of the Order of the Sacred Hearts, started. Bizarre murder cases in Oregon's history. During the investigation, police examined examined the odd bruises on Ebba's head and found a strange reddish mark from her upper lip across her neck and her cheek. They also found that her neck appeared disjointed, as if powerful hands had twisted it. Consequently, they turned to Fred Covell as their most likely suspect in Ebba's murder, largely because he appeared strong enough to strangle his wife. It likely didn't help that he was sullen and uncooperative when the police questioned him. Suspects were Fred's 15-year-old son, Alton, and his brother, Arthur, who admitted being in the house when Ebba died. Though Arthur and Ebba openly hated one another, he had the best alibi of all. He was paralyzed in a truck accident years earlier, so he was primarily confined to the bedroom. Arthur also had a reputation for being rather peculiar, given the fascination with astrology. He had a lucrative mail-order astrology business and for being a seer, so police didn't take him seriously as a suspect. There was no possibility he could have committed murder since he needed strong crutches to walk. As for Alton Covell, the history of intellectual impairments and lack of any animosity against his stepmother caused police to dismiss him as a suspect. The actual evidence against Fred Covell was slim at best, if you didn't count neighborhood gossip and their frequent quarrels, but he was still arrested. However, Fred wasn't in jail for long after a coroner ruled out strangulation as the cause of death. The coroner also found burn marks on her face, which he concluded was because someone smothered her with a cloth dipped in ammonia. The case broke wide open after the police searched Arthur Covell's room and found a journal containing entries in a special code. It took them a while to break the code, but the police soon had what amounted to a full confession. The decoded journal included notations such as, "Today is the day. I wonder if Alton will go through with it." But Arthur had more grandiose plans than just ridding himself of his hatred sister-in-law. He also intended to have Alton carry out dozens of other murders in the abandoned area, guided by astrology. Arthur assumed his paralysis gave him a perfect alibi, so he planned to use his mail-order business to trick people out of their money or change their wills to make him the beneficiary. He planned to send Alton to dispatch his victims and burn their homes to hide any evidence. The plans of Arthur Covell were so detailed that they even called for the removal of windows and doors before the home of the victim was burned, said Bandon Detective Luke Esmay. After Arthur's arrest, the stolen articles were to be used in a home at the Covells' plan to build. With this information in hand, the police questioned Lucille Covell, Fred's daughter, who was also in the house and had overheard Arthur and Alton planning Ebba's murder. She was intellectually impaired like her brother, but Lucille told the police she had not told anyone what they were planning because she was afraid of getting her uncle in trouble. When the police told Alton about Lucille's statement, he confessed to murdering his stepmother. As he explained, Arthur Covell told him that Ebba's murder was fated since he saw it in her horoscope. The stars told Arthur the exact time the murder needed to take place. Alton, easily dominated by the uncle he believed to have supernatural powers, went along with the same scheme. And so at 11 a.m. on September 3rd, Alton followed Arthur's instructions exactly. "I put the ammonia on the rack," Alton said, "and Ebba was standing by the stove. I walked up to her from behind and on the right side. I put the rack often applied much ammonia to the cloth and left traces of it on Emma's face. Ammonia is harmless to living tissue, but the burn marks on Emma's dead body were cleared enough to the coroner. With Alton's confession, police interrogated Arthur Covell a second time, during which he confessed to his sister-in-law's murder and absolved Lucille in front of any involvement. In fitting display of poetic justice, he received the jail cell where his brother was held just hours previously. Local newspapers end the field day with this story, with headlines such as "Finnish crime laid bare by confession and lurid details were all outlawed," and Arthur Covell was labeled a super criminal with an occult hold over his nephew. The evidence against Arthur included Alton's confession, and Lucille's testimony was overwhelming. He was quickly found guilty and sentenced to hang. Arthur, who attended the entire trial while laying in a special cot placed in the courtroom, simply raised himself on the cot when he heard the verdict and thanked everyone for how the case was handled. After Arthur was successfully convicted, there was the question of what to do with Alton. During the trial, his attorney, Grant Corby, introduced expert testimony to show that Alton had the mental age of an 11-year-old and argued his client was mentally unfit. The prosecutor countered this argument with letters that Alton wrote to his sister, warning her to keep her mouth shut and that she would end up in reform school. For a small part of the killing, it took the jury less than an hour to find Alton guilty, but with the recommendation to receive a life sentence, Alton became his life sentence, for which he would receive a conditional pardon just a few years later. But Arthur's execution had a problem. There were repeated attempts at an appeal, and he was hanged on May 22, 1925. At the penitentiary in Salem, Oregon. Due to his paralysis, he was taken to the gallows in a wheelchair and physically carried up the steps to where the hangman waited. His body was so light, the hanging failed to break his neck, and he wasn't pronounced dead until 26 minutes later. His remains were cremated, were never taken after his death, and his current whereabouts of the remains were unknown. So, that is all the stories that I pretty much read.